an epic nova exploded in the Milky Way is gone. And now? Sunday, August 8th, while in Tokyo, the Olympic flame was being extinguished and the end of the games was celebrated with a fireworks display. A new light lit up the night sky, or rather it was rekindled, after 15 years from the last explosion recorded on February 12, 2006. RS Ophiuchi, a so-called recurring nova, that is a star that increases its brightness at more or less regular intervals, came back to shine with overbearing power. Many people, once they heard the news, tried to look for the star, which appeared in the constellation Ophiuchus, and someone more timely than others has also managed to capture, with the help of maps and binoculars, the vision of a very weak and insignificant star, immersed like many others in the middle of the great river of the Milky Way. A bright dot that experts gave a magnitude of plus 4.8, and then just four times brighter than the faintest stars visible to the naked eye, which is attributed to a magnitude of plus 6.5. From the point of view of the show, let's admit it, there was not much to see. The real beauty of the phenomenon, as we will explore in a moment, is the fact to observe it with the awareness of what it really is. That is, a cosmic catastrophe. But someone seems not to have been able to see even that little. How come? Well, the answer is simple. They waited too long. 5 days after the explosion, in fact, the star had already returned to the limit of visibility to the naked eye. And in mid-August, if it was already weaker than magnitude plus 8, it was necessary to look for it immediately without basking in the idea that the star would remain visible for a long time, for weeks or months. In fact, Novae stars are quick to appear out of nowhere, but just as quick to return to the shadows. Remember that next time. Many centuries ago, on a July night in the year 134 BC, mankind was struck for the first time by a strange and unexpected sight. A new star had lit up in the sky. The star shone with a bright splendor for some time, then slowly faded and disappeared. As Pliny, the famous Roman historian and naturalist, wrote, the strange apparition included the Greek astronomer Hipparchus to compile a catalog of all known stars, so that posterity could know if there were really changes in the sky. And posterity did in fact observe numerous changes similar to those of 134 BC. Until today, we can count the appearance of 1,000 stars in our galaxy, not all of them equally bright. The ancients, who when they witnessed the phenomenon mistakenly thought of the birth of a new star, gave these stars the name Novae. But today we know that in reality, those stars are not born at the moment they appear to our eyes, but it simply happens that in a few hours they increase thousands of times their brightness, passing from the condition of star observable only with large telescopes to that of star easily visible to the naked eye. It is not a rare phenomenon. It has been calculated that in the Milky Way alone, about 30 novae are lit every year, but many of them are not observable because they're too far away or hidden by clouds of interstellar gas. Currently, a dozen or so are discovered each year. Increases in brightness so large and so fast can only be justified by a colossal release of energy. But caused by what? For what mysterious mechanism a small and weak star comes to emit energy with such violence? Even today, astronomers are squabbling over the details, but it seems now established that the scenario capable of explaining this incredible phenomenon is that of two stars that by mutual gravitational attraction form a so-called binary system. It must be a particular system, however, formed by a white dwarf and a star with a mass slightly greater than the solar one that is in the red giant phase. While dwarfs have a diameter similar to that of the Earth, but a quantity of matter equal to that of the Sun. Therefore, they have a great density and a gravitational force tens of thousands of times higher than Earth's one. And thanks to the intense gravitational field, the white dwarf attracts hydrogen and helium from the outer layers of the red giant and attracts them to its surface, increasing mass and volume. Gradually, the attracted gas, heating in its fall, thickens on the dwarf to form a spiraling accretion disk that continuously transfers new material from the red giant to the dwarf. The incandescent hydrogen that continuously pours on the star compresses the underlying matter until it mixes with it, triggering a reaction that results in an unstable condition. An explosion ensues, following which the star's luminosity can increase 150,000 times, and the surface temperature can rise to 100 million degrees. The white dwarf returns to the initial stage in a period of time between a dozen days and a few months, but then immediately resumes the process of accretion that will lead in due course to a subsequent explosion. The process is repetitive but not strictly periodic. For these variables are valid, at least qualitatively. The law of Kukaran and Parenago, according to which the time between the two explosions is longer than the increase in brightness. We speak in this case of recurrent novae, but it is widely believed among astronomers that all novae repeat, although some do so on such a large time scale as to have made them virtually undetectable to man throughout history. But beware, although the novae of all types recorded in our galaxy amount to a few hundred, the recurring ones are very rare, just a dozen. They are physical systems with properties intermediate between normal novae, stars that show enormous variations of luminosity from 8 to 15 magnitudes with great rapidity, then slowly decay to normal luminosity, and dwarf novae, known to present more moderate variations of luminosity from 2 to 6 magnitudes, but much more frequent with periodicity from 10 to 1,000 days. The recurrent novae behave in an intermediate way, showing brightness variations from 4 to 9 magnitudes, in periods from 10 to 100 years. They are therefore events that cannot be considered rare in astronomical terms, but certainly difficult to observe systematically. Well, something very similar to what we have described so far must have happened on RS Ophiuchi on August 8th, or rather, something must have happened more than 5,000 years ago. Since this is the distance that separates us in light years from the binary star that bears this name. Evidently, 5,000 years ago, the white dwarf of that system had been freed in an instant of all the material stolen from the red giant with which it lives for millions of years, transforming everything into energy and light radiation, a catastrophe of planetary proportions. Fortunately, such turbulent binary systems are not able to form a planetary system, so there is no embarrassing risk for us Earthlings to applaud a cosmic event that in the meantime is wiping out millions of creatures. In short, rest assured, certainly no one was hurt on RS Ophiuchi. The 2021 outburst was its ninth resurrection in 123 years of observations. Previous outbursts had occurred in 1898, 1907, 1933, 1945, 1958, 1967, 1985, and 2006. Of course, there is no way to know if there have been others before 1898. But it's safe to assume that this streak of recurring explosions had been repeating for hundreds of thousands of years, or even longer. Who knows? The event of August 8th was, however, quite special, since the brightness reached was one of the highest ever recorded by this nova, which, let's remember, in the exclusive club of recurrent novae, the second absolute for brightness after T. Corona Borealis, which, in its appearance of 1866 and 1946, reached the magnitude of plus 2.5. Incidentally, none of the other recurring reaches naked eye visibility, not even during the brightest appearances. But let's take a closer look at the behavior of RS Ophiuchi from its discovery until today. The story begins with the 1898 explosion, but it was not directly observed. Only in 1904, examining some photographic plates, the American astronomer Wilhelmina Fleming noticed a nebular residue that she suspected might have been released by a nova. This was later confirmed by the position of subsequent explosions, identical to that of 1898. The 1907 appearance occurred early in the year, when the star was unobservable due to conjunction with the Sun. However, the flare is considered highly probable because just after the conjunction, the brightness was lower than that recorded just before the conjunction. The outburst of 1933 that reached magnitude plus 6.4 at the limit of visibility to the naked eye was the one that convinced astronomers that the star was a very rare nova recurring at short period. Also in 1945, RS Ophiuchi appeared in conjunction with the Sun. In that case, however, there was a more prolonged observation of the last phases of the flare, which made its attribution more certain. In 1958, the nova returned to manifest itself, reaching in mid-July the magnitude of plus 6. The outburst of 1967 occurred on October 27th, and on that occasion, the star reached magnitude plus 5. In 1985, 27 years after the previous eruption, the star turned again on January 26th, reaching magnitude plus 5.4. After that, it was necessary to arrive on February 12, 2006, to see RS Ophiuchi break the wall of the fifth magnitude and get up to plus 4.5. Record almost equaled August 8th with a magnitude of 4.8. At this point, one is left to wonder, but these cyclical resurrections, will they continue forever? Actually, no. To hear most astrophysicists tell it, RS Ophiuchi's fate is to explode as a Type 1A supernova within 100,000 years. Confused for a long time with novae, supernovae represent a far more energetic explosive event. At its peak brightness, a supernova can increase by 20 magnitudes, 100 million times, and exceed the sun's brightness by 10 billion times, a phenomenon completely destructive, revealed as well by the enormous amount of energy emitted, by the observed speed of expansion that is around 10,000 kilometers per second. Type 1A supernovae occurs starting from scenarios very similar to that of recurrent novae, in binary systems formed by a white dwarf and a red giant. The only difference is in the mass of the dwarf. Below the limit of 1.4 solar masses, the so-called Chandrasekhar limit, the dwarf does not have the strength to trigger thermonuclear reactions, even in its core, and therefore continues its life as a recurrent novae. But if the dwarf, during its explosions, is not able to get rid completely of hydrogen stolen from the red giant, then its mass can progressively increase and exceed the limit until the sudden destruction of the whole system. Well, apparently the RS Ophiuchi white dwarf seems to be going on this way. It is increasing in mass, and very soon, within maybe 100,000 years, it will overtake the Chandrasekhar limit. Our great-grandchildren, in that distant future, could thus witness the ignition in Ophiuchus of a star perhaps brighter than the moon. But keeping our feet on the ground, will those who missed this summer's nova have to wait another 15 years? Isn't there some other recurring nova that may be reactivating soon in our galaxy? Yes, we think so. Keep an eye out for you, Scorpii, and also T. Corona Borealis. Some hope instead for an explosion of a galactic supernova that in the terrestrial skies, which hasn't happened for 400 years.